Since Canon announced the R5C back at the beginning of the year, one of the most common questions we've had about it is, should I buy this or the C70? And honestly, it's actually quite a hard question to answer. But in this video, we're going to try and help you understand which one might be best for you. The main reason that these cameras are being compared is because of their incredibly similar price point, with only £300 being the difference between them. Of course, there are a bunch of other cameras at this price point that may be worth looking at, but today we're going to be focusing on just these two. What the overall price of your package comes out at will really depend on what you need the camera to do. At the end of the video, we will look at the pricing of things in a bit more detail. The C70 and R5C have fundamental design differences. The C70 has been designed solely for motion acquisition, whereas the R5C is aimed at being a hybrid camera that does both video and photo really well. We can also see this in their physical design, as the C70 can't take any stills at all, whereas the R5C basically has the same functions as the R5 built into the camera. We can also see this in the sensors used by each camera. The R5C features a full-frame sensor capable of capturing 8K RAW. It's similar to the one introduced with the R5, but improved processing has resulted in better video imagery over the R5. The R5C also features a dual native ISO sensor, whereas the C70 does not. This will result in cleaner imagery when shooting at the higher ISOs. The footage we managed to capture with the camera earlier this year is honestly incredible. It's really detailed, has great Canon colors, and decent dynamic range. This sensor is honestly great for both stills and video acquisition. And if you do want to soften up the image a little bit, you can easily by dialing down the sharpness in post or in camera, or just chucking some kind of mist or soft filter on your lens of choice to soften things up a little bit. The C70 features a Super 35 4K sensor, which was first introduced in the C300 Mark III. And this means it features the same DGO tech, which is partly how Canon are achieving such great dynamic range out of the C70 and the C300 Mark III. We've shot with the C70 a bunch and really love the image quality that it can produce. It's a really versatile image that makes the camera great at capturing a large range of different jobs. When we compare them, I would say the R5C is more detailed due to the increased resolution, but does have less dynamic range and latitude than the C70 does. Because of this increased dynamic range, the C70 features C-Log2, which can hold more dynamic range than the C-Log3 profile in the R5C. Some people think the C70 footage looks soft, but I really don't think it is. Though, if we compare it to the 8K or downsampled footage out of the R5C, I can understand why some people may think it does look soft. But the C70 has better highlight roll-off and a more natural looking image in my opinion. Really though, the image out of both of these cameras is excellent, just slightly different for different people's needs. Rolling shutter performance is quite similar between the two when shooting dual gain output on the C70. However, it looks to be better when not in DGO compared to the R5C. One of the biggest differences between the two cameras for video shooters has to be the built-in ND filter that the C70 has. The C70 system allows you to quickly go from a clear filter to 10 stops of ND in 2-stop increments. This is awesome for really any video work, but especially run and gun solo operators, where you may need to change your exposure fast while keeping your shutter and aperture locked. The ND quality is good, and it's one of the biggest pros for the C70 over the R5C. As the R5C doesn't have an ND system built in, you'll need to either use a front-mounted ND or an ND-RF adapter. A front-mounted option is more of a pain to use, but will allow you to use RF lenses. And an adapter ND will be better to use, but will just limit you to EF lenses. You will also need to remove the ND for a clear option on the front or swap to a clear on the adapter ND system if you needed no ND for a shot. So basically the C70 system is far more convenient and faster to use than the systems for the R5C. And once you've used a camera with an internal ND system, going back to one without one will be very annoying, trust me. If we look at all the recording formats for both of them, we can see that they're actually quite comparable. Though I would say that the R5C does have the slight edge due to the option to shoot 4K 120 in slightly better formats. When it comes to recording media, the C70 and the R5C do differ. The C70 has a dual SD card slot, whereas the R5C has an SD card slot and a CF Express Type B slot. You will need to use CF Express Type B to record some of the larger data rate recording formats. If we look at media cost between V90 SD cards and the CF Express Type B cards, only a few months ago Type B was a bit more expensive. Now with the introduction of more Type B options, it's actually cheaper than some V90 cards. However, both can add up quite quickly if you want to grab a few cards. One thing worth considering though is the size of the files between the two cameras. If you want to shoot 8K, your cards will last a lot less than if you're shooting 4K. This means you'll need more cards, which increases the cost of media needed for the R5C over the C70. What media you will need though will come down to your needs and what formats you mainly want to record in. There are also benefits to shooting CF Express Type B though. Physically, they are much more robust than SD cards, which when you're investing a couple of £100 into a single card, you will want. You can also get larger Type B cards than equivalent speed SD cards. These cards are also much faster than SD cards, which means that with the correct reader, you can offload your rushes much, much faster. When it comes to editing the rushes from both of these cameras, there is actually quite a big difference. Of course, capturing in 8K is great for many reasons. However, editing it can actually be quite challenging on hardware that can't handle it. There are a couple of workarounds for this when shooting with the R5C. The first being the ability to shoot downsampled 4K in the camera or by batch processing these 8K files through Resolve down to 4K. How long this takes will really depend on your workstation. We found doing this through Resolve on our Mac Studio to be relatively fast, and we can also color grade our clips during this process too. Or of course, you can just get in the habit of creating proxies, which plenty of people do. When it comes to editing C70 files, we haven't had any issues with any of our Windows or Mac workstations at all, just great performance all around. When it comes to usability, the cameras both have their own pros and cons, as their body designs are actually quite a bit different. The C70 is a decent amount larger, which could be seen as a good or a bad thing. It's good because it has more space to put custom function buttons, but it's bad as it does make it more challenging to configure onto different support equipment. However, it's not the kind of size of a C300. You are going to be able to put it onto gimbal still pretty easily. The camera kind of feels and looks like a 1DX that's kind of been cinema EOS'd, whereas the R5C is very similar to the R5, apart from the cooling fan that's been chucked on the back. This means that it's great for gimbals or car mounting, as you can keep it stripped down, and then when you need to rig it back up, you easily can. Both can record for unlimited periods of time due to them both featuring these robust cooling systems. They're also both good to use for handheld shooting or can be rigged up as you need to. The R5C really needs a cage to make it a more versatile camera due to the limited mounting options on it. Luckily, these aren't super expensive from the likes of small rig. The C70 also has cage options available, but you may actually not need one with it. The C70 comes with a top handle and a mic mount out of the box, which is great, but I do recommend this small rig portable kit as a key accessory for the C70. I personally find the handle much nicer than the included one, though if you want to run a shotgun microphone, you may want to stick with the original one. The top plate adds a good amount of mounting points, and the bottom plate is really crucial as it allows you to mount the tripod plates using two screws instead of just the one that is possible without it. If you want some more advice on rigging up your camera, get in touch with us or even book a demo at our Newman House location, where you can rig up your camera with one of our technical consultants on hand to make your rig tailored exactly to what you need. We've also done a how to upgrade video for the C70, and we are planning on doing one for the R5C as well. Link to that is in the description below. The C70 also has a thread on the side of the camera, which can be used to mount the camera in a portrait orientation, whereas the R5C will require an L bracket or a cage to do this. In both cameras' menu systems, you have the ability to rotate the orientation of the on-screen display, which means you can easily shoot vertically. This is great as portrait video is something that more and more clients are demanding now with the increase in popularity of more mobile-friendly content. The R5C's rear LCD is much more robust than the one found on the C70. This C70's LCD hinge is such an unnecessary oversight from Canon. Fortunately, if you do have a problem with one and do need to send it back to Canon to fix it, they will actually reinforce the hinge now to make it stronger, which is really what it should have been like from the beginning. When in video mode, the R5C runs a very similar operating system to the C70, which means both are very well featured when it comes to shooting tools. This means the same great exposure and monitoring tools, same white balance function, same autofocus parameters, and much more. Personally, I think the C70 has a better body design for shooting video. The addition of buttons and a more Cinema EOS style layout makes it an easy transition for anyone who's shot on legacy Cinema EOS cameras. But the body design does also make it easy to transition from a DSLR or mirrorless camera. However, the EVF on the back of the R5C could be a very important thing for some shooters. Its quality is excellent, and when shooting in bright conditions, it does come in very handy. Using a viewfinder on the C70 will require a few bits of rigging and a few hundred quid invested into a viewfinder. When it comes to HDMI output, the C70 uses a full-size HDMI port, whereas the R5C uses a micro HDMI. Anyone who's used micro HDMI before will know how terrible it is. So it does mean that the included cable protector is a must for peace of mind that you aren't going to damage your cable, or even worse, your camera. One of the biggest drawbacks in my eyes for the R5C has to be the battery life. Because of what the camera can do internally, it means it requires a lot of power. And this means that a single LPE6 NH will not give you much recording time at all. though this does depend on what frame rate and recording format you choose, but they can last as little as half an hour. So you'll need to either carry loads of LP6s around or run some kind of external battery, which is actually what we used when we reviewed the camera earlier this year. There are plenty of third-party options for rigging up a power source, but one option I've seen several people use is the battery grip for the R5C, which allows you to use two LP6 batteries and kind of turns its form factor into a slightly smaller C70. If we compare this camera's power draw and battery size to the C70, we can see just how much longer a single BPA battery will last when compared to an LP6. I've shot for an entire day with only changing the battery once with the C70, and that definitely would not be the case with the R5C. You can also get third-party batteries that have different power outputs for the C70, such as this CoreSwix one here. This will allow you to power accessories like a monitor via the DTAP on this, which is really handy. The C70 also comes with a power supply out of the box, which is a small detail, but for anyone shooting in more studio or controlled environments, it saves you having to grab one, which you would have to do if you get an R5C. When it comes to autofocus performance, both cameras feature Canon's dual pixel autofocus system. In the R5C stills mode, it runs the more up-to-date version 2 of this system, but in the video mode, it runs the same version 1 as the C70. Due to the faster processor that the R5C has over the C70, I have found it to be a touch faster. Otherwise, they both feature pretty much the same modes and parameters for controlling them. However, the R5C has eye detection on top of face detect, whereas the C70 does not have eye detection. If you want the best autofocus performance, I would suggest grabbing RF native Canon lenses, as from our testing, they provide the best autofocus experience. As both of the autofocus systems are pretty contrast based, your exposure and lighting conditions will really affect how good the performance is. So if you want the best performance, make sure to not underexpose your image. The lenses you grab for each camera can actually be quite similar. Both cameras feature Canon's RF mount, and currently there are only really a couple of RF APS-C zooms, mainly because the R7 and R10 have only just really come out. So at the moment, you'll be looking at full frame RF mount lenses or looking to adapt older EF mount lenses onto the C70 or even cinema lenses. Using a speed booster is also a good option with the C70 if you want to get close to that full frame look. We reviewed the Canon 0.71 focal reducer a while ago, and I've also broken down how focal reducers work in previous videos, links to which are down below if you want to learn more. Though one thing that we have seen since looking at the Canon focal reducer is the purple flare issue that it has, and overall lower contrast when shooting in harsher, varied lighting conditions. This kind of issue isn't surprising with focal reducers, but it is worth considering if you are looking to pick one of these up. So overall, both cameras have good options for lenses. Canon's RF lenses are excellent, but they are pricey, so for some, adapting EF lenses could be a good option. For people interested in cinema lenses, the Super 35 sensor of the C70 means that you can use more of them, both new and old. However, the R5C does have a Super 35 crop mode if you do want to use a lens without full frame coverage. Audio is such a crucial component for cameras in this area of the market, and Canon has been great in this regard since the introduction of the original C300. The R5C has a 3.5mm mic input on the side of the camera, but you can also use the Tascam top unit, which will directly communicate with the camera via the updated hot shoe on the top of the camera. This allows you to bypass the camera's internal preamp, resulting in much better quality audio, and it also provides two XLR inputs and a bunch of camera control. This is a great solution for the R5C, though recording externally and syncing in post could also be a good option. The C70 features two mini XLR inputs on the side of the body, as well as the 3.5mm mic in and headphone out. While it is annoying they're not full-size XLRs, you can easily get cables to use your favourite XLR microphones directly into the C70, or you can grab a full-size XLR adapter module like the Wooden Camera A-Box if you don't want to use mini XLR cables. The preamps in the C70 are great, so going directly into the camera for recording audio is definitely a solid option. For me, I'd always prefer to have the audio module built into the camera, as I don't like the design of these XLR top units. They just give me the heebie-jeebies with easily knocking it and snapping it. It's nowhere near as robust and solid as having the XLRs built into the camera. The C70 also has a full BNC for timecode, whereas you will need a DIN adapter for the R5C. Defining a shooting package is difficult, as what each person needs for their work will differ slightly, but we can make some slight generalizations on price. As we mentioned at the beginning, the cameras have a roughly £300 price difference between them. If we want to add the XLR top unit for the R5C and an ND solution, that is an extra £500 for the XLR unit and £400 for the Canon NDEF adapter, which pushes the R5C up quite a bit. Media is cheaper for the R5C and batteries are cheaper, though you will need more of them due to the higher power draw and lower capacity. So I would say once rigged up, the R5C actually ends up being more expensive, just slightly if you need the XLR top unit. Otherwise, they are priced so similarly that I really don't think it will be a major factor when you choose between the two cameras. I've put together a list of some key accessories for both down in the description below. And if you want some more tailored advice, get in contact with us via the details down there too. The R5C is a fantastic hybrid camera. If you want to shoot stills and video with one camera, it's the obvious choice. As a video camera, it's still excellent, with really detailed imagery that looks fantastic. Its drawbacks are its battery life when using LP6 batteries, its body design, and larger, harder to process files. For most video-orientated shooters, the C70 is honestly going to be the better choice though. It's a camera designed just for video, and that shows in its physical design and feature set. The built-in ND system and mini XLR inputs make it ready to shoot out of the box, without the need for extra accessories bolted onto it, like the R5C will need to get similar features. I also think the 4K files out of the camera look fantastic, while also being easy to process in post. The extra dynamic range will also be something that filmmakers would appreciate. The drawbacks are the lack of detail in comparison to the R5C, larger body design, slightly slower autofocus system, and of course, it doesn't have any photography features at all. If you have any more questions about the cameras, let us know in the comments below. We've done massive reviews of both of these cameras, so if you want to learn more, check them out on our channel. Let us know which you would choose in the comments below, and if you like the video, please give it a like and maybe even consider subscribing so you don't miss out on our awesome upcoming content. And thank you so much for watching.